Hello everyone. Hope you all are fine. Let's have some study time. Today we are going to start with equilibrium. This chapter is divided into two parts, chemical equilibrium and ionic equilibrium. We are starting with ionic equilibrium today. So this is Arpita Banerjee and you are watching Arpita Classes. Like where ions are combined together to give you a molecule like this. These are the ions combining together to give you molecules. Or maybe any molecule is dissociated to give you ions. Okay? Or maybe any two ions combining together to give you some different ions. All these type of reactions are called as ionic reactions. These are all ionic reactions, and whenever we talk about the equilibrium of these type of reactions, then ionic equilibrium come into the picture. So if these reactions are unidirectional, that means if the reaction is happening in one side, we cannot talk about equilibrium. Equilibrium only will come in case you have a reversible reaction. So first of all, this thing should be very clear that if the reaction is reversible, then only the equilibrium concept will come into the picture. So say a very famous reaction, it is always given in the book, like CH3COOH dissociates to give you CH3COO minus and H plus. For this type of reactions where a molecule is dissociating into ions and it is also a reversible reaction, so we can talk about ionic equilibria in this case. Now, about this concept, many scientists had studied about this concept, but the scientist who first time gave some contribution on this topic was Faraday. What Faraday saw, Faraday tried to find out where the ions are present. Where do you get the ions? So you get the ions in aqueous solution. If any ionic compound is dissolved in aqueous solution, the ionic compound will get dissociated in the solution. Faraday also found out, he took sugar solution, okay, he dissolved sugar into water, so that is called a sugar solution, and he saw that sugar solution does not conduct electricity. Does not conduct electricity. That means what? There are no ions in the sugar solution, there are only molecules. Because we know that electricity is only conducted whenever ions are present over there. So in sugar solution, Faraday observed that there is no conduction of electricity and he concluded that there are only molecules. On the other hand, he took some salt solution and he observed that it conducts electricity. That means salt solution contains ions. So on the basis of this, Faraday divided all the solutions into two parts. He called all the different solutions into two parts. Basically, he gave this name electrolytes. Faraday said that anything, any substance when dissolved in water, if it conducts electricity, they are called as electrolytes. Okay? So the substance which when dissolved in water or in the molten state conduct electricity, they are called as electrolytes. Also, these electrolytes can be differentiated into two parts, weak electrolyte and strong electrolyte. Weak electrolyte and strong electrolyte. What are weak electrolytes? Weak electrolytes are those which will only partially dissociate in the solution and will give you less number of ions. They will only partially dissociate in the solution, not completely dissociated, they are only partially dissociated, or very small amounts of ions are obtained from weak electrolyte. And strong electrolytes are almost 100% dissociated. So they are completely dissociated. Strong electrolytes are completely dissociated in the aqueous solution. So, we will not talk about the strong electrolytes over here. basically strong electrolytes will 100% dissociate. So we will not get equilibrium in case of strong electrolytes. So we will not talk about strong electrolytes. For example, suppose you take NaCl. NaCl will dissociate into Na plus and Cl minus, and you see this arrow is unidirectional towards the forward direction. So all the NaCl molecule will dissociate into ions. We will not get the equilibrium, and hence we will not talk about the strong electrolytes. We are going to only talk about the weak electrolytes. For example, CH3COOH, you dissolve this into water, it will dissociate into CH3COO minus and H plus. So in any point of time, you are going to get these ions as well as the molecules. There will be an equilibrium setup in between the ions and molecules, and hence we are going to talk about the weak electrolytes. Now these electrolytes can be acids, bases or salts. In chemistry, we have only these three types of compounds, acid, bases and salts, and electrolytes could be anything. We have also seen that electrolytes are of two types, strong and weak electrolytes. Now, we will take the example of strong electrolytes. What are strong electrolytes? Any strong acids, like in acids, if I take any strong acid, for example, HCl is a strong electrolyte. It is a strong acid, hence it will be strong electrolyte. HNO3 is a strong acid, will be a strong electrolyte as well. H2SO4, strong electrolyte, strong acid, therefore it will be strong electrolyte. HClO3, all the strong acids will be strong electrolyte. Similarly, when you talk about bases, all the strong bases will be strong electrolyte. For example, NaOH, KOH, calcium hydroxide, magnesium hydroxide. So basically, group 1 and group 2 metal oxides and metal hydroxides are strong bases. You can just note it down. Group 1 and group 2 metal oxides and hydroxides. Metal oxides and hydroxides are strong bases. Okay, so acids, all the strong acids are strong electrolyte. All the strong bases are strong electrolytes. In case of salts, salts are produced by acid and base. In case of salt, if any component is strong, the salt will be strong. For example, if I say take NaCl. Now, NaCl is made up of NaOH, strong base, HCl, strong acid. So, NaCl is a strong electrolyte. KCl, made up of KOH, which is a strong base, HCl, which is a strong acid. So, KCl is a strong electrolyte. Suppose if I say CH3COONA, now this salt is made up of a weak acid CH3COOH, but a strong base NaOH. So if any component is strong, then the electrolyte will be strong. For example, NH4Cl. NH4Cl is made up of weak base, that is NH4OH, which is a weak base. Okay, but it is made up of a strong acid HCl. Now, since one component is strong, the electrolyte will be strong. So, any salt whose both the components are strong or only one component is strong, it will become a strong electrolyte. Okay, so you got the examples of strong electrolyte. Now, suppose if I take any strong electrolyte HCl, what happens if I dissolve this into water, I get H plus and Cl minus. Complete dissociation takes place. 100% dissociation occurs out here. So we do not get the equilibrium. Here, the degree of dissociation, degree of DOD is degree of dissociation, which is denoted by alpha. Alpha ka matlab kya hota hai? One mole se how many moles we get? That is alpha, degree of dissociation. From one mole of an electrolyte gives you dissociated into how many moles? That is alpha. Alpha is here completely 1, or you can say it is 100%. Complete 100% dissociation occurs, and after some time when you start doing this reaction, you get only ions and no molecule. That is why we will not deal with the strong electrolyte, because in case of strong electrolyte, we will not get the equilibrium established. Okay. Now let us take the examples of weak electrolyte. We are going to talk about this only. So you need to understand what are weak electrolytes. All the examples of weak electrolyte you have to keep in mind. First of all the weak acids. There are many weak acids. Many weak acids. All the organic acids are weak acids. Okay. So for example, ethanoic acid, CH3COOH. Formic acid, HCOOH. Carbonic acid, H2CO3. Hydrogen sulfide, H2S. Then you have hydrogen cyanide, HCl. You have benzoic acid, C6H5COOH. All these are weak acids. Weak acids, all the organic acids are weak acids, remember. Also you get carbonic acid, then you have H2S, HCl, these are all weak acids. Weak bases, all the weak bases are weak electrolyte. For example, NH4OH, this is weak electrolyte. Dimethyl amine, this is a weak electrolyte. Trimethyl amine, this is a weak base and weak electrolyte. So these are all weak electrolyte. Pyridine, C6C5H5N, this is called as pyridine. Even this is a weak electrolyte. Okay, and in salts, if both the components are weak, then the salt is a weak electrolyte. For example, NH4CN. Now see, NH4CN, this salt, ammonium cyanide, is made up of what? It is made up of NH4OH, which is a weak base, and it is made up of HCN, which is a weak acid. Since both the components are weak, therefore NH4CN is a weak salt. Okay, similarly, say NH4 whole twice CO3. Ammonium carbonate. Let us see the components. Ammonium carbonate is made up of NH4OH, which is a weak base, and carbonate comes from H2CO3, which is a weak acid. So both the components are weak and hence the salt is a weak electrolyte. So these are the examples of strong electrolytes and weak electrolytes. Here in this chapter, we are going to talk about only weak electrolytes because the degree of dissociation of weak electrolyte is only till 5%, not more than 5%. Means what? Suppose if I take CH3COOH in aqueous solution, it will dissociate to give you CH3COO- and H+. I put this reversible sign, means this is a reversible reaction. The reaction will occur in both the direction, and if you calculate the DOD, degree of dissociation for this particular reaction, you will get it is not more than 0.05 or almost equal to 5% or maybe less than 5%. So for this type of electrolyte where the DOD or degree of dissociation only is still 5%, we get the equilibrium and hence we can talk about that. Okay, so we understood what are electrolytes, what are weak electrolytes, what are strong electrolytes. Here in this chapter, we are going to talk about only weak electrolytes because those reactions will establish the equilibrium. Now let's come to the next topic, and our next topic is acid-base concept. What are acid, what are bases? So to explain this concept, acid and base, many scientists had come to the picture. The first scientist who came, his name was Arrhenius. And Arrhenius' concept is very, very significant. We need to know. Today we are not actually following Arrhenius' concept, but this is the first concept which was given by Arrhenius, and he said that anything will be an acid if in the aqueous solution it furnishes H+ ion as the only positively charged ion. Arrhenius said that any substance will be an acid if its aqueous solution furnishes H+ ion as the only positively charged ion. Okay, I'll explain you this. Suppose, or some people also say that not H+, some people also say H3O+, which is also called as hydroxonium ion. This is hydroxonium ion or hydronium ion. Now, how do you get hydronium ion basically? The H+, which is given by the acid, it will react with water. Because aqueous solution means you have water. So, H+ will react with water to give you H3O+. So whatever is H plus, that is only H3O plus. So there is no difference. H plus and H3O plus is the same thing. H plus is basically devoid of electron, and water has got lone pair of electron. This water has got lone pair of electron. So whenever the H plus will be coming in contact with water, this lone pair of water is given to the hydrogen, and that is how you get a compound like this. There is a coordinate bond because this is given to hydrogen. So there is a coordinate bond and the entire compound contains a positive charge. This is your H3O plus. So some people say that acid is a compound whose aqueous solution furnishes H plus ion or H3O plus ion as the only positively charged ion. They are called as Arrhenius acid. Similarly, for bases, Arrhenius said that base is a compound whose aqueous solution furnishes OH minus ion as the only negatively charged ion. As the only negatively charged ion. Means what? If you take NaOH and you dissolve this into water, NaOH will dissociate into Na plus and OH minus. Since you get OH minus from this, when it is dissolved in water, therefore NaOH is termed as Arrhenius base. Now this only positively charged or only negatively charged ion is very important. Why I am saying that? Because suppose you take NaHCO3, this is sodium bicarbonate, which is a salt, we know that. You dissolve this into water, we get Na plus, H plus and CO3 2 minus. We cannot call this an acid. It is giving H plus ion, but we still cannot call this an acid because it is also giving Na plus ion. If it would have given only one H plus ion, we would have called it as acid. Since it is giving Na plus as well, this is not an acid, this is a salt. So this is very important that when the substance dissolved in aqueous solution gives only H plus ion as the positively charged ion or H3O plus, it is an acid. And when a substance dissolved in water gives only OH minus ion as the negatively charged ion, it is called as base. This is Arrhenius concept of acid and bases. Now we need to know what are the limitations of Arrhenius acid and bases concept. The limitations are, first limitation is, acids and bases are categorized only in the aqueous solution. Okay, without aqueous solution, Arrhenius could not classify acids and bases. So acids and bases could be classified only in aqueous solution. This was the first limitation, because later on it was found out that CO2 has acidic nature, SO2 has acidic nature, P2O5 has acidic nature, but Arrhenius could not explain why these are acidic because they do not even contain H+. So Arrhenius could not explain that. Secondly, Arrhenius could not explain why the metal oxides are bases. Metal oxides could not be classified as bases. Whereas we know that Na2O is a base, MgO is a base, calcium oxide is a base, all the metallic oxides are bases, but Arrhenius could not explain they are bases because they do not contain OH minus ion. If they don't contain OH minus ion, they will not dissociate into OH minus ion when they are dissolved in water. So first thing, Arrhenius, to classify anything, acid and bases, water is required. That is the first thing. In dry condition, Arrhenius would not explain something is acid or something is base. For example, HCl gas in dry condition also shows acidic property, but Arrhenius would not explain why that is so. NH3 gas is basic, it shows basic property, but Arrhenius would not explain why. Secondly, metal oxides would not be classified as bases because they do not contain OH minus ion. So these were the limitations of Arrhenius, because of which a concept had to come into the picture, and that concept is Lowry-Bronsted concept. So now we are going to study what is Lowry-Bronsted concept. So now we are going to talk about the Lowry-Bronsted concept. So give the heading Lowry-Bronsted concept of acids and bases. This is a very important concept which says that acids are proton donor. Any substance which has the capability of donating H plus ion are acids, and bases are proton acceptor. That's all. They are proton acceptor. So any substance which has the capability of donating H plus are categorized as acids, and any substance which has the capability of accepting proton are categorized as bases. देखो एग्जाम्पल बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है. सपोज HCl एंड वॉटर. HCl इज डिजॉल्व्ड इन वॉटर. व्हाट हैपेंस इज HCl लिबरेट्स H प्लस विच इज टेकन बाय H2O. सो इट गिव्स यू H3O प्लस एंड Cl माइनस. सी व्हाट हैपेंस, HCl इज डिसोसिएटेड इनटू H प्लस एंड Cl माइनस इन प्रेजेंस ऑफ वॉटर. And water is taking this H plus to convert into H3O plus. This is hydroxoniamide. How this hydroxoniamide is formed, I already explained some times back. Okay. So what is happening? See, HCl has been converted into Cl minus by donating H plus. HCl donates H plus and converts into Cl minus. Therefore, HCl is categorized as acid. H2O is converted into H3O plus by accepting H plus. It is accepting H plus, therefore it is categorized as base. See what is it? Again, I'll explain you. HCl reacting with water, giving you H3O plus and Cl minus. HCl converts into Cl minus by donating H plus. H plus is donated. Therefore, HCl is categorized as an acid. H2O converts into H3O plus by accepting H plus, and therefore H2O is categorized as base. We'll take one more example. See, NH3 is dissolved in water. You get NH4 plus plus OH minus. See what is happening. NH3 converts into NH4 plus by accepting a proton, accepting H plus, and therefore it is categorized as bases. H2O is converted into OH minus by donating H plus, and therefore H2O is categorized as an acid. I'll repeat, NH3 plus H2O, you get NH4 plus plus OH minus. NH3 converts into NH4 plus by accepting H plus. Since it is accepting H plus, therefore it is a base. H2O converts into OH minus by donating H plus. Since it is donating H plus, therefore it is categorized as an acid. Now, in this both the reactions, if you see, water here is acting as a base and water here is acting as an acid. So Lauri-Bronsted theory says that acid and base is a relative matter. That means it depends on the reaction. Any substance can act as an acid or any substance can act as a base. It depends on the reaction. So please note it down, acid-base concept is a relative concept and depends on the reaction. So according to Lauri-Bronsted theory, any substance which can accept the proton will be a base, and any substance which can donate a proton will be an acid. So according to that, base could be any negatively charged species, because any negatively charged species can accept H plus, or it can be some neutral species as well. Let us see some example. Any negatively charged species or neutral species can act as bases. For example, suppose Cl minus. It is a base. Why? Because Cl minus have the capability of accepting H plus. Okay? I say CO3 2 minus. It's a base. It can accept H plus. SO4 2 minus. NO3 minus, Br minus, O2 minus, F minus, OH minus, HSO3 minus, HSO4, HCO3 minus. All these are bases, all these negatively charged spaces are bases because they have the capability of accepting a proton. Similarly, NH3 is a neutral species but will act as a base. Why? Because nitrogen has got lone pair of electron. And if it has lone pair of electron, it can accept hydrogen. It can accept proton, not hydrogen, proton. Similarly, ROH, alcohol. Alcohol can act as a base because it has lone pair of electron on oxygen, so it can accept proton. So any species with negative charge or with lone pair of electrons can act as a base. I hope this is clear to you. Now we will move on to our next concept, that is, say I have HCO3 minus. If you add H plus to this, it will become H2CO3. And on the same species, if you take out H plus from here, it will convert into CO3 2 minus. See what I'm saying? HCO3 minus can accept a proton and convert into H2CO3. HCO3 minus can lose a proton and convert into CO3 2 minus. So this species has got both capabilities. Accepting a proton means it is acting as base, and here it is donating a proton means it is acting as acid. So any species which has got both capabilities of being an acid and base are called as amphoteric species. These are called as amphoteric species. Why amphoteric? The meaning of ampho is both. Meaning of ampho is both. So there are certain species which can gain proton, which can even lose proton. Let us see one more example. Say HSO4 minus. This is called as bisulfate ion. Bisulfate ion, if take one electron, it will convert into H2SO4, not electron, sorry, proton. Bisulfate ion, when accepts a proton, it will convert into H2SO4. So here it is acting as a base. At the same time, HSO4 minus, if loses one proton, it converts into SO4 2 minus. Here it is donating a proton, therefore acting as an acid. Hence, we can call it a amphoteric species. Please copy it down. So let us take one example of water molecule. Suppose I am taking two molecules of water. One molecule of water will accept a proton to convert into H3O plus, and another molecule of water will donate a proton to convert into OH minus. So H2O, which is converted into H3O plus by accepting a proton, will be a base. On the other hand, H2O, which is converted into OH minus by donating H plus, will be an acid. So in this particular reaction, one molecule of water is acting as base, another molecule of water is acting as acid. So even water can be called as an amphoteric species. Now, if you understood this concept, let us take one more example. HCl plus NH3 is giving you NH4 plus plus Cl minus. See, in this what happens? HCl has been converted into Cl minus by donating a proton. So HCl is an acid. On the other hand, one more thing, NH3 has been converted into NH4 plus by accepting a proton. Therefore, NH3 acts as base. Now, look at the same reaction from the opposite direction. Suppose Cl- has a capability of accepting a proton. That means it can be a base. NH4+ has a capability of converting, donating a proton, because NH4+ converts into NH3 by donating a proton. Therefore, it is an acid. वापस बोल रही हूँ, HCl reacting with NH3 to give you NH4+ and Cl-. When we look at this reaction from this direction, HCl converts into Cl- by donating H+. Therefore, it is an acid. NH3 converts into NH4+ by accepting H+. Therefore, it is a base. Look at the same reaction from the opposite direction. Cl- converts into HCl by accepting an accepting a proton. Therefore, Cl- is a base. NH4+ converts into NH3 by donating a proton. Therefore, NH4+ is an acid. This HCl and Cl- is called as conjugate acid base pair. HCl and Cl- are known as conjugate acid base pair. Similarly, NH3 and NH4+ are called as conjugate acid base pair. Copy it down. I'll give you more example. These things are now going to be a little complex. You need to understand nicely. Suppose I have HCl. It converts into Cl- by losing H+. So HCl is an acid. If you see the same reaction from the opposite direction, Cl- converts into HCl by accepting a proton. Therefore, this is a base. These two are called as conjugate acid base pair. I'll take another example, say NO3-. If you add one proton over here, it will convert into HNO3. So NO3- accepting a proton, it is acting as base. From HNO3, if you remove one proton, it will convert into NO3-. This is donating proton, therefore it is an acid. So NO3- and HNO3 are conjugate acid base pair. So if I give you 1000 examples, everywhere you will see the conjugate acid base pair, they differ by a hydrogen plus, one hydrogen plus. This has a hydrogen, this does not have a hydrogen. This has a hydrogen, this does not have a hydrogen. So the conjugate acid base pair will differ by H+. Let us take one more example, H2CO3 plus H2O, giving you H3O plus HCO3-. Now H2CO3 has been converted into HCO3- by donating H+. Therefore, this is an acid. H2O converts into H3O plus by accepting H+. Therefore, this is a base. Same reaction, if we look at from this side, HCO3- converts into H2CO3 by accepting a proton. Therefore, this is the base. And H3O+ converts into H2O by donating a proton. Therefore, this is an acid. So from here, we can see H2CO3 and HCO3- is conjugate acid base pair. Similarly, H2O and H3O+ is conjugate acid base pair. Now, if you look at the conjugate acid base pair, they differ by hydrogen. देखो यहाँ पे H2CO3, यहाँ पे HCO3, एक हाइड्रोजन का डिफरेंस है. H2O, H3O+, एक हाइड्रोजन का डिफरेंस है. So any conjugate acid base pair will always differ by hydrogen. We'll take one more example. NH3 plus H2O gives you NH4+ plus OH-. NH3 converts into NH4+ by accepting electron, sorry, proton, accepting H plus. Therefore, it is a base. H2O converts into OH minus by donating H plus. Therefore, this is an acid. If we see the opposite reaction, OH minus convert into H2O by accepting proton. Therefore, it is a base. NH4 plus converts into NH3 by donating proton. Therefore, it is an acid. So, here also we have NH3 and NH4 plus. NH3 and NH4 plus as the conjugate acid-base pair. Also H2O and OH minus as the conjugate acid-base pair. If you look at the conjugate acid-base pair, they differ by hydrogen. NH3, NH4 plus. One hydrogen differ karta hai. H2O, OH minus, they differ by one hydrogen. So if you understood this concept, I'm giving you one example now. One assignment to do now. There are some species. You have to write down the conjugate acid of this and conjugate base of this. I'm giving you the species. You have to write down the conjugate acid and the conjugate base. You have HCO3 minus, HS minus, NH2 minus. Please write down the conjugate acid and conjugate base. Pause the video and do it. I'll do it in some time. Okay, hope you all are done. Let's see now. To make some species a conjugate acid, you have to add H plus. And to make it a conjugate base, you have to subtract H plus. So if you add H plus to this, your conjugate acid is H2CO3, carbonic acid. You subtract H plus from here, you get CO3 2 minus carbonate ion, which is a base. HS minus, add H to this, you will get H2S, which is an acid. Subtract H, you will get S2 minus, which is a base. NH2, add H, it will be NH3. And subtract H, it will be NH2 minus. So this is how we can convert any species into its conjugate acid and conjugate base. Just remember, for making a conjugate acid, you add H plus. For making a conjugate base, you subtract H plus. Let us see some more example to make this idea clear. Find the conjugate base for. And this side you have find the conjugate acid for. You have to find the conjugate base for H2S number 2, HS minus number 3, HCN. And find the conjugate acid for HPO4 minus number 2, you have NH3. And number 3, you have SO4 2 minus. Find out the conjugate bases for this species, conjugate acid for this species. Pause the video and try it out. I'll tell you in some time. Okay, hope all of you are done. So let us see, find the conjugate base for. So whenever you have to find the conjugate base, you have to subtract H. So subtract H from here, it will be HS minus. For this one, it will be subtract H, it will be S 2 minus, and for this one it will be CN minus. These are the conjugate bases. For conjugate acid you have to add H. For this it will be H2PO4. This is NH4 plus and this is HSO4 minus. It was 2 minus, so when you add one hydrogen it will become 1 minus. So this was the concept of Lauri-Bronsted acid-base concept. What was the limitations of this concept? It was a very good concept, but the limitations were, in modern time actually all the concepts shifted into electronic concept. People started talking about acids and bases when the electrons are gained or electrons are lost. So all concepts shifted to electron. Lauridbronsted basically categorized acids and bases in terms of proton. But in modern times, when Lewis came, that time he actually explained acids and bases in terms of electron. So all the concept shifted to electron first thing. And also, this concept cannot explain the acidic nature of BF3, SNCl4, FeCl3, etc. There were some species like BF3, SNCl4, FeCl3, these were all showing acidic property, and Lauridbronsted concept could not explain how they are acids in nature. So this is the reason that later on Lewis concept came into the picture. And what Lewis concept says, this is an electronic concept which came into the picture around 1923. And he says that acid are those substances which are electron acceptor, and bases are those substances which are electron donor. That's all. So as per Lewis, acids are electron acceptors, bases are electron donors. So which species can accept an electron? Any species which is positively charged or maybe electron deficient can accept an electron, and therefore they are categorized as an acid. For example, say any positively charged species like Ag plus, H plus, H3O plus, Cu2 plus, Na plus, Mg2 plus, all these positively charged species, they can accept electron, and hence everything can be classified as an acid. Now this is very strange that how come Na plus, Mg plus, Mg2 plus can be an acid, but according to Lewis' concept, they are acids, because Lewis just said anything which can accept electron. Na plus is electron deficient, it can accept electron, therefore it can be categorized as an acid. Neutral species, where we can see, in neutral species, the species which are electron deficient, they are neutral but they are electron deficient, so they have the capability of accepting electron. For example, BF3, electron deficient, AlCl3, electron deficient, SnCl4, these are all electron deficient. How come? Just check out. BF3, if you see the structure of BF3, this is the structure of BF3. These are two electrons, these are two electrons, and these are two electrons. Even after making the covalent bond, B, boron molecule is having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 electrons. This is called a 6-state condition. It has the tendency to keep 8 electrons in its shell, but it is only having 6 electrons. So this is an electron deficient species, and therefore it will be acting as Lewis acid because it can accept electrons. Okay. So according to this concept has become so general that every species can be categorized as acids and bases. Acids are only those which can accept electron. So any positively charged species or any neutral species which is electron deficient can be categorized as acids. On the similar concept, when you talk about bases, negatively charged species are bases because they can donate electron. For example, Cl minus, Br minus, S minus, S2 minus, O2 minus, NO3 minus, HSO3 minus, all these negatively charged species, they have a capability or tendency to donate electrons, and therefore they are bases. Or you can say the neutral species where lone pair is available. For example, NH3, nitrogen has lone pair. H2O, oxygen has lone pair. Alcohol, oxygen has lone pair. All these are having lone pairs, so they have a capability of donating electrons, and therefore they act as a base. So after Lewis concept has come to the picture, the acid-base concept has become very, very generalized. You can say anything as an acid, you can call anything as a base. It is just on electronic concept. anything which can accept electron is an acid, anything which can donate electron is a base. The reaction between a Lewis acid and a Lewis base. Suppose I take BF3 as a Lewis acid and NH3 as a Lewis base. Let us see what is the product. Now BF3 is this molecule. We'll draw the structure of BF3. This is electron deficient, and NH3 is this molecule, and NH3 has got a lone pair of electron. So what happens? NH3 gives this lone pair of electron to BF3, and there is a coordinate bond between these two. So we get a compound like this, BF3. This is a coordinate bond from NH3 to BF3, because a lone pair is given by NH3, and we get this. This is a salt. Because we know that when acid and base reacts together, we get a salt. So this is how this compound, which looks like a complex, is basically a salt. You can call it as a Lewis salt. Similarly, one more example we'll see. Nickel. Nickel is an acid because nickel has got vacant d orbital. If you see the electronic configuration of nickel, it is 3d8. Nickel is 28 atomic number, electronic configuration is 3d8. Matlab uske paas d orbital mein jagah hai, vacant d orbital hai. And that is why when it reacts with carbon monoxide has got lone pair of electron. So this gives lone pair of electron to nickel, and they form a compound which is nickel carbonyl, tetracarbonyl nickel, this way. This is actually a coordination compound, or it is a complex compound, but here nickel act as an acid and carbon monoxide act as a base. Because nickel has got vacant d orbital, it can accept electrons in its vacant d orbital, and carbon monoxide has got lone pair of electron, it can donate lone pair of electron to nickel. And that is how the compound is formed, that is tetracarbonyl nickel, which is a coordination compound or a complex compound which we are going to study in 12th standard. But even this is a Lewis acid and Lewis base reaction. So that is it for today. We have started the chapter right from the beginning. We have seen what are electrolytes, what are the two different types of electrolytes, weak electrolytes and strong electrolytes, the examples of electrolytes and all that, and then we saw the concepts of acids and bases. There are three different concepts of acids and bases: Arrhenius concept, Lorentz-Bronsted concept and Lewis concept. So our first lecture gets over here. In the next lecture, we are going to talk about the ionization constant, or you can say the equilibrium constant only, basically, which is here will be called as ionization constant, and then ionic product of water. Thank you so much.